now, the Crypt and Blake's Countdown of Forever Songs.
Speaking of crushing awesome badasses you want to support, look who's popped in. What's up, Blake? How are you, sir?
How's it going, man?
I fucking am so happy to see you, man. You kick ass, brother. How you doing?
It's been a while. Well, the last time we did was right before Halloween, I think.
That's right. The Halloween show. We did some horror movie stuff. That's right.
Right. At least you didn't ask me to pick a super obscure shit today, because I'd still probably be doing it.
Yeah. Hey, we lean on you. We lean lightly sometimes, and we lean heavily other times. We'll lean lightly a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate you joining me. And for those who do not know, introduce yourself. I'm sure they already know because they're metalheads, but give them that anyway.
My name is Blake Harrison. I'm in a band called Pig Destroyer. I'm in a band called Zealot R.I.P. I'm in a band called Hate Beak. And I'm in a band called Pupil Slicer.
Hey, I applied too, man. After hearing that, how can you not apply, right?
Hell yeah.
That's good. And you are also part of Metal-O-Mania, man. Blake is a semi-regular. We try to drag him in here and talk metal with us every now and again when able. If you missed our Halloween episode, you do want to go into the archives and check it out. We talked horror movies.
We talked obscure horror movies, or somewhat obscure.
It was fun, too.
You and I could do a deeper dive on that, but
yeah,
you gotta have stuff when you do this so people can find it.
Well, we'll do another one this year for Halloween, and we'll go deeper cuts. That's all.
Yeah. Oh man, I gotta start boning up now.
Yeah. Right. That's what I'm telling you now. Shit. I gotta give you that pre-spring update for that Halloween job.
Shit. I only have 8 months.
Right. You're so much like me when it comes to that shit, man. I'm already worried about how I'm gonna get it done. So.
Yeah, dude, when I write my blog, it's always like, I get to pick which records I review, and I always kind of sweat it, man. I'm like, it's not fun just to trash it. So I'm like, I don't like Machine Head, so should I review it? Or, like, should I review this thing that nobody's ever going to like? Even I like it. But
I love it, right. Yeah, that's a tough line to cross.
Yeah, so.
It's all about personal taste, man, and different people devour their music in a different way. Some people use it. Of course, some people have they consume it, shit it out, and other people it stays with you forever. And that's kind of what we're going to talk about a little bit today.
Exactly.
Blake has just joined us today because we're going to run down, for all of you metalheads out there, mine and Blake's personal lists of 10 forever songs. Forever songs. And let me tell you all out there our definition somewhat is, other people might say these songs are overplayed or they played to death, but for us, they'll forever be a part of our soul, right? What do you think?
Most definitely, and I probably could have done way more than 10 in each. You asked for metal and not metal. And I specifically stayed away from, kind of metal adjacent. Like, I didn't pick punk or, like, harsh industrial. I mean, I'm shocked I didn't sneak Ace of Base in there. And then when you and I were texting earlier, I'm like, oh, fuck, I forgot about this. Oh, shit, I forgot about, I should have included a David Bowie song.
Yeah.
So I tried not to pick stuff that's like for that, at least, stuff that isn't quote unquote metal adjacent, so people could get into like stuff on their own.
Well, fuck, I hope you don't consider any of my picks cheating when we get to my
No, of course not.
and of course, the idea of being here, I guess when I started to make my list, I pictured what are songs that no matter what's going on in the world, or in my room, or in my wherever I am, when I hear this song, I stop, drop everything. It's all about this song right now, goddammit.
I mean, that is, like, super tough. Some of that depends on your mood and,
so much.
How inebriated you are. I'm not a big fan of dance music at all. So,
Right.
And obviously, when you and I were talking specifically about Elvis Costello, and I was like, fuck, man, I could have picked, basically the first 8 records.
I love Elvis Costello, yeah.
Almost anything on any of those 8, but
I Want You by Elvis Costello was my last cut that didn't make my final list here. But
it didn't make it, huh? I mean, that's a brutal song, man.
It's tough to make a list of 10 of this kind of shit, So I had a tough, I think I started with, just jotting off the top of my head, I had, 40 songs on both lists. So I'm like, fuck.
And, I think it's a thing with people kind of our age range too, growing up there was a lot of radio, so you got, and radio was a lot different and better back then. Not to sound like the old get off my lawn dude, but you would have rock songs and hard rock, and now it's radio is just garbage. You know, garbage. Pop, country. I actually listened to 98 Rock the other day and was like, never heard of a single fucking artist they were playing. It's like, dude, what is this? And it doesn't sound like rock to me, but.
Right, it's garbage.
Yeah.
It really is, man. There's a station here that calls it. So, well, you're familiar with it. You're local. DC 101 is playing like Billie Eilish songs, man. What the fuck?
Yeah, like, I mean,
what did I miss? Play
Billie Idol.
Yeah, right.
You know?
Right. It's crazy, man. It's crazy. Well, I guess before we do dive into our list, though, well, you mentioned David Bowie, you mentioned Elvis Costello. Those are two that just fell off the back end of my list that didn't make it. Who were some of the ones that you had to put a pin through to get it down to 10 that you were like, fuck, this is painful? Because I had a few David Bowie for sure, like you said. And
I got to be honest, man. I still really like Morrissey, this whole stuff, and the Smiths, but it's like such, it's kind of polarizing these days. And I didn't feel like justifying that. So like,
he's hard to defend, but he's you know, his tapes and music is rock solid. I mean,
you know, like I couldn't pick one Cure song, you know, and that type of stuff is kind of like, you know, post-punk or new wave. So that's almost punk anyway. So yeah, it was really tough. I actually had not that hard of a problem with the metal aspect of it, but you know, after I sent it to you, I'm like, oh fuck, there's like seven more I can pick right now.
Yeah, without even easily. Any
thoughts, right. You know.
And I want you listeners out there thinking, what is your 10 forever list? Play along with us from home. But yeah, I totally agree, man. And it's one of the, it's definitely a deal where what if I asked you today on a Monday to give me your 10 and then ask you again on a Friday, it might be a whole different fucking list. You know?
Most definitely. 100%, man. I mean, you know.
So take that for what it's worth, ladies and gentlemen. Well, let's get to it. Just our format here, we decided it's a metal show, so of course we had to do metal songs.
Of course.
So 10 metal songs that are forever songs to us. But I thought that we should definitely add in a list of non-metal songs because that's more get-to-know-you type of stuff. And I want to get to know you better, Mr. Blake.
Hell yeah.
Fuck yeah. So let's do our 10s then. Dun-dun-dun. So what we'll do then is we'll unveil our 10s and then our 9s and we'll break it down that way. We'll do our metal song first, and then we'll do our non-metal song. That way, everybody can kind of get to know us a little bit. So
exactly.
Let's start with your number 10 song and your number 10 band and on your metal list. And, dude, you got a good one here. Forbidden, Chalice of Blood.
So, you know, I remember in the Thrash Explosion, they were like a, you know, I would say like fifth, sixth tier band. Definitely not super upfront. But I heard that band and I really dug it, mostly because the vocals were so different. He had kind of the high-pitched scream. You could tell there was, like within and like Red Child America, there was like a more, they were kind of like a different band probably before they became a thrash band. And with Chalice of Blood, you can really hear that come through. You can hear the traditional metal in that song. And I don't know, man. It's just like kind of over the top for the time. I mean, there was death metal bands singing about way worse shit. But like, just, I don't know. Chalice of Blood, it's a fun, silly kind of song. And that's where What's-His-Face Rob got his start, unless he was in Sanctuary first.
I thought it was Forbidden first, honestly, actually. Yeah.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm not a huge Machine Head fan. So, yeah, Rob Flynn. Yeah.
But Forbidden, my God. Twisted into form, just all of it. You know, I'm a huge, love them motherfuckers, man. Huge.
You know, and I think I got, like, there was some kid in my high school that had that, the Forbidden Evil shirt. And I was like, oh, what is that? That's badass. And I probably bought that tape from Waves Music in Laurel Mall or something like that.
Yeah, fuck yeah.
It might not have been Waves. It might have been something else. But
Waxy Maxy's over at Bellway Plaza, baby.
I actually live about a mile away from the original Kemp Mill.
Oh, no shit. That's awesome.
Yeah.
I used to live there.
What was the original Kemp Mill? But, yeah.
That's good shit. Well, yeah, man. Forbidden. You can't get wrong with Forbidden, man. Old school metalhead. I know lots of people that feel they don't get the credit they deserve, and I agree with every single one of them.
Yeah, I think they definitely kind of are very underrated and not really talked about too much anymore. Probably because they're not really doing shows. Like every other fucking band on the planet has gotten back together to play in some of these fests, which is totally badass.
Right.
But I don't know that Forbidden's ever done that. So if I'm wrong, you can blast me in the comments.
they might have done a few things, but I'm hoping. I believe they're listed as active on their encyclopedia page. So.
Oh, very cool.
We'll see. You know, hopefully that means new metal coming.
Yeah.
My number 10 list is kind of very similar in that vein. I had to go with Testament. I almost went with Over the Wall from their debut, but I had to go with Trial by Fire, honestly. It takes me very much back to the Headbangers Ball days when I hear that song.
Yeah, I mean, those two songs are very, you know, Over the Wall is a great jam, but it's one of those I feel like it's always like dudes our age always like, well, I'm so old school. Like, yeah, it's a great song, but Trial by Fire is badass too. I kind of fell off the Testament because it kind of like slowed down a little in my eyes. But those first like couple records are still really solid thrash records, man.
Oh man. If you want to get your thrash bone tickled at all, I do recommend the most recent Titans of Creation, man. Very good.
Really? I haven't checked that out yet.
Exceptional. I put it in my top three on 2020 releases, honestly. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. A real solid fucking record start to finish.
Nice.
So yeah, Testament makes my list, but now let's go to the fun one. What's number 10? On Blake's non-metal list here. Let's see. Oh, Eddie Money. I think I'm in love. I think I'm in love.
Yep. So, I love
it. I think I'm in love.
Love the hits, man. And this is kind of like one of his hits that I think is not, it's probably his like smallest or least charting hit. This song kind of reminds me of, I mean, it's just straight rock. And it's like, I don't know, man. It's hard to explain to anybody if you don't really, like, there's no fucking wacky saxophone in it. He isn't being like the overblown ego, big headed fuck face that he became.
Remember? Whoa.
It's just like a solid rock. I mean, just when that first, you know, guitar note hits, man, you know you're in for something. And I don't really care for the subject matter as much, but it's still a ripping jam, man.
That's a great jam. I love that money.
I think that blows Loverboy, which basically copied that whole format. I think that blows Loverboy out of the water. Loving every
minute of it. Right on, dude. You know, although I will say, when I was young, I loved me some Loverboy. Boy,
that was me too. But like, you stack that song against any Loverboy song, man, that song rips
for sure. I love Eddie Money. I was sad when we lost that dude. It was, you know.
Yeah.
Even though those commercials were not a good thing, that was not good for. But
no, I think he had. There's a friend of mine who prank called him a bunch, and I think he was on having some rough times. Like, you know. This guy's a pretty famous prank call guy. His name is Longmont Push and Castle. But he tortured Eddie Money. And he's like, I live in a Motel 6, buddy. He's like, dude, that sucks.
Leave me alone, motherfucker.
Like late 70s, early 80s, he was huge.
Yeah, huge, yeah. Crazy, man. Take me to two tickets to paradise. You
tickets
take
to
me
paradise?
Home yeah.
Shaking?
Yeah, oh, shaking shit. I made it. Me and Scully did a video where she was dancing around for me all sexy looking. I put that Eddie Money shaking to it, and I still look at that video on a regular basis. Shaking, Scully. Okay. Well, my non-metal number 10 on my list was – I went very 80s pop on it a little bit. I'm old, I guess, but I had to go with the Cars, man, Moving in Stereo.
That's a really good car song, dude. I've got a car song on my list, too. But, yeah, is it really pop? I mean, it's still kind of rock. And yeah, there's a theory that's been told that the Dead Boys, like one of the first punk bands, quote-unquote, was told that they would be signed a major if they kind of toned their sound down and like did a little more radio friendly. And then they broke up, and Cheetah Chrome heard the Cars and was like, motherfucker, they did it. Somebody did it. So I always thought that was kind of, and Moving in Stereo, dude, if you don't talk fast times at Ridgemont High, that's one of the best topless scenes you've ever seen.
It truly is, man. Dude, it's very tied to Fast Times at Ridgemont High in my mind, too. That definitely plays a role in why I love it. That's one of my favorite movies ever, so, you know.
Oh, 100%. And I think, you know, a lot of the stuff you and I picked, and this dates us, is probably, like, video songs. You know, there's, like, a lot of videos that tied into it. For sure. Or those artists. I mean, you know, fucking, the Cars had, like, what, 3 singles off every record?
Right.
The best of the Cars is like an undeniable hit, man. Like every single song on it was awesome.
Yeah, no shit, dude. Truly is. My best friend's girl, all of it. Rick Ocasek was a fucking badass. So
very, very, very intelligent dude, man.
Yeah. Another tough one we lost.
Yeah.
All right, let's go to our nines, or I'll keep you here all night, man. Number 9 on your list. Talk to me about, oh, look, we were talking about them earlier. Talk to me about some Bolt Thrower.
So, you know, I'm a big Earache Records kid from when that death metal explosion first started. And Bolt Thrower is, I think, one of the more underrated, like, because they do a couple shows here and there. They didn't really break up. So they put out some records, and they're really solid. They're just not as good as their intro. I mean, everyone can talk about Morbid Angel and Napalm Death all day, and those made my list, too. But, you know, Bolt Thrower and Autopsy, I think, are a little bit underrepresented in more of the mainstream metal culture. I think you can find anyone with all black pants, all black shirt and spikes loves Bolt Thrower. They love Autopsy too, because they're like crustier, they're like filthier. And you know, I just think they're kind of an underrated band. Like nobody, you don't really see a lot of people talking about how Bolt Thrower changed the face of modern death metal.
But they did.
They most definitely did.
Yeah. And, dude, I love that you have a penchant for the dirty, for the raw, for the, you know.
Yeah, I mean,
we share that.
Not just a metal dude. I'm a old punk rock kid, too, so kid, 45. But, you know, the kind of crustier, the better. And, you know, there's even some stuff now that I'm like, man, this is so filthy. But I just won't listen to it because it's way too, you know, pretty extreme for a 45-year-old, too.
Well, man, I grew up a punk myself. I had the mohawk, the whole thing. And again, I hope I didn't break the rules. I might have a little bit of punk on my non-metal list. But
I mean, there's not rules. You did non-metal. I just wanted to go a little bit in further direction.
I'm a fucking only a few trick pony, so, you know.
I mean, I could have given you my top 50 punk, my top 50 metal.
I might have you come on and we'll talk punk. I'm a punk guy, so.
I'd love that.
So my number 9 metal song, I went with, people who watch the show on a regular basis are probably sick of me bringing up John Arch era Fate's Warning, but it's such a huge part of my life. I can't, you know, that was when I was getting into metal. And
again, a completely underrated band, man. Fate's Warning was fucking dope as shit.
So bad.
And like, you know, not technically thrash, I don't think, but they definitely have that element.
For me, they're really, I give them very large response, almost a Godfather role in prog metal, if you don't mind my saying so.
Most definitely, yeah.
You know?
Them and Watchtower were kind of like not the exact same, but similar in my mind.
I love them.
Where they were kind of like, you know, you can just play a couple power chords and be heavy, and that's cool. But, like, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to do something different.
Right. We're going to be extreme and extravagant and bring, you know.
Coroner did stuff like that kind of in a different way. It was, like, very early progressive death metal that, you know, we just kind of called it metal then.
And right, like, yeah, right.
Heavier than thrash, but not quite death.
Right. It is funny to think about that now. We have all these different genres. Back then, it was just all metal, you know.
Yeah.
Warning, Black Sabbath, Iron Maiden. It was all just metal.
I mean, you would say, like, you know, I remember someone being like, have you ever heard Winter? They're real slow. And no one said Doom.
Right, you know? Right. Yeah, fuck. We're dating ourselves for sure. Hey, dude, I remember when the first time somebody gave me the Vincent Matthews, who was in Criminal Element, who used to be with Dying Fetus, gave me a cassette tape, and he was like, dude, check out this band Metallica. That's how old we are.
Wow, yeah.
All right, well, Faith Warning, yeah, I love me some Faith Warning, man, so I had to put that on there. John Archer stuff, it was tough for me to pick a song. I went with Guardian, but I could have went with so many. Fata Morgana, I could have went with, you know, the Prelude to Ruin, I could have went with fucking Damnation, or I just love so much of that stuff. All right, but let's move over to number 9 on our non-metal list. Your number 9 non-metal list, and this one I got a kick out of, man. Give me some Frank Stallone, baby!
Okay, so do you know this song?
I do, yes, sir. Yeah, well, I'm old like you, man.
Right. So I've been recently, during quarantine, obsessed with this song for some reason. And I think it's just because, I mean, it was probably in some Sylvester Stallone movie, and I don't remember which one, like maybe Over the Top or something like that.
It might have been Over the Top. That's funny, yeah.
And it just like, I mean, you don't get more fucking 80s than this song. I mean, Cyndi Lauper, Madonna, that type of shit, yeah. But, like, just the way it's written, the way that he uses the keyboards. When you hear it, you can just hear it, the montage from a movie where the guy goes from, like, 300 pounds and loses 200 pounds and becomes, like, the weakling to the muscle man and then beats his contender. Whatever it is, I think it was Over the Top, which is probably, I think it was about arm wrestling, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But, like, yeah.
It's great montage music.
It's a righteous jam, and, like, anyone that feels like they can't go jogging because quarantine, just put that on, man. It's like you'll start jogging.
That's right, brother. Overcome.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, that's great, man. That's great.
But, I mean, it is a cheesy, tacky-ass song, but it's still fucking awesome.
Hey, it's fucking awesome, and it screams 80s, man. It gets up on a soapbox and screams, 80s!
I mean, it is Sylvester Stallone's brother too.
Yes, yes, sir. So, yeah, like, you and I took that for granted, but yeah, some of the younger viewers may not realize that. So yeah, that's Sly's brother, Frank. All right, my non-metal number 9 list. I went with some Thin Lizzy, man. I went with Jailbreak. It was tough for me to pick one, but.
That's a jam, and that's probably, if I'd have to pick a Thin Lizzy song, that's probably my favorite. I mean, they've got some, you know, the Emerald and Boys Are Back, but the Jailbreak is just, like, it's just got that slink to it, man.
Well, yeah, you said a minute ago that kind of grittiness to it. I feel like that song really has a gritty element, you know, that I dig.
Yeah, and it's, you know, it's, like, still in keeping in, like, rock tradition. It's about breaking out of the jail. It's not, like, you know, it's those traditions were, like, chicks, booze, or breaking out of jail.
Yeah, like, right.
So, you know, it's not some, like, the Emerald is badass, and, like, Whiskey in the Jar, which isn't really their song, but they have adopted it.
Right.
Black Rose. I mean, they got so many fucking great songs.
So many great songs.
When we played Ireland a couple of years ago, we were like super beat, and I think our flight was like super fucking early, like 6 a.m. or something. But somebody took us to go see this Thin Lizzy cover band, and I've never seen a band so fucking good. Like, those youth lived it.
Yeah, I love that. That's good shit, man. Well, some people may not realize, what is it, the Black Something Riders? I forget. The surviving members of Thin Lizzy are in a band now that actually, they put out a few albums that are good. I'm fucking
well,
with the name right
which
now.
Members? I mean, they're like, as the guitar players, they had so many different guys in and out of that band.
Right.
But if it's Garrick Moore, man, I'm sold.
I think he is a part of that project. We'll share a link or something. But
yeah, it'll make sense. It would make sense that he is.
All right, well, let's move to number 8 on our list. Let's go with your number 8 metal choice, and that would be motherfucking Danzig.
Briefly, I love Danzig. I saw him on the first tour. I've seen him on a ton. I love Sam Hain. I love the Misfits. I love some of those adjacent bands. There's a band that had Eerie Vaughn called Morning Noise before he was in Sam Hain. There's a band called Rosemary's Babies. There's a band from Japan called Ballsack that sounds like the Misfits. I'm into it. And as much of a cheese dick as Danzig is, I don't have CDs or tapes. I collect records. So they recently reissued Danzig 2 on vinyl. And I picked it up, and I was, like, listening to it. I'm, like, just kind of sparked this, kind of renewed interest in that first record. And how fucking – his voice is badass. Possession is awesome. It's by far the darkest song in that record. And this is way before, him carting kitty litter across the street or getting knocked out, I mean, Danzig was a dark, creepy dude at the time.
Fuck yeah.
It was way before Danzig got into the Delta Blues too hard, or like the Nine Inch Nails stuff he kind of did later. I mean, this is just pure Danzig. And John Christ is a Maryland boy. It's from Laurel or Towson,
yeah.
I think.
Towson, yeah.
So it was real tough for me to pick any song off that record. Or I really like Exodus, Parasite. It's got to be in my top 10, but it did make it. That's kind of why I went with Possession.
Yeah, I love it, man. Danzig, Misfits. Ah, that. He'll always have an awesome role in my view, so.
And if it happens, we're supposed to play Psycho Las Vegas this year. It was supposed to be last year, obviously. And Danzig is headlining the night we play, and he's playing Lucifuge in its entirety.
Oh, so, awesome.
While my girlfriend and everyone else go sits at the bar, I'll be up front.
Yeah, you're damn right.
Fuck yeah.
As a metalhead and a metal fan, my friend.
Exactly.
My number 8 metal song, I went with Iron Maiden's Revelation. Again, another band with a discography that's about 72 miles long, so. The lights of the blind, you'll see. The venom tears my spine. The eyes of the Nile are opening, you'll see. Tough to choose a song.
Just one Iron Maiden song.
Right. It was. I almost just went with Iron Maiden. That's enough. But
right.
Since I had to name a song, I went with Revelation. It's one of those songs when it comes on, I become Bruce Dickinson for the entirety of the song, no matter where I'm at. That's.
Well, and if you listen to the way that song's kind of composed and paced, it's a lot different than anything on that record. It's got like the spaces between some of those chords in the beginning. Or maybe not in the beginning, but in the middle. You know exactly what I'm talking about. And it's not just kind of like Iron Maiden always fills up all the gaps with something. A solo or fucking Steve Harris kicking ass or a drum fill. And this one has a little more space in it. And I think this is a badass song, man.
Fuck yeah. Ugh, Maiden. All right, well, everybody's eager to know our non-metal. I know all the metalheads out there want to know our non-metal too, even more. So, talk to me. All right, you got some. I'm going to say this wrong. So, Neubauten? I am unfamiliar with this pick, sir.
Okay. Einstürzende Neubauten. They are a German kind of proto industrial. Noise band. They do a lot of weird shit, especially on this record. This record is called Halbermensch. It means half man. And this was my first introduction. When you look it up, you'll notice like Rollins has a tattoo that their logo you've seen everywhere.
Okay.
The name itself means like new buildings falling or new buildings collapsing. But this was, when it was kind of my intro to fringe, what I call like fringe kind of noise music. I just thought it was a bunch of people making a racket and was like, fuck, I don't care about that. And this is the first song off that same record. They're both called Halbermansch, but it's got this chant. It's fucking dark. It's awesome. I was like, this isn't just a bunch of assholes feedbacking and kicking a guitar down the street. Like, they are banging on pots and pans and shopping carts and pipes and doing all kinds of weird shit. And, you know, the main guy, Blixaw, has said that, you know, within everything that's exists, there's some music waiting to get out. So for me as a 16-year-old kid, I was just like, my mind was bent. I had no idea what to compare this to. And it's still going. And every one of their records is different. I mean, I saw them once in a performance, and they mic'd a sheet of sheet metal and dripped candle wax on it.
Oh, that's awesome.
I would have preferred a little more traditional.
Right, that's bizarre, but yeah. All right, well, I got a feeling you're sending me on a journey here. I'm going to have to check some of this out.
Yeah, and like, seriously, when you see, look at that logo up, you're going to be like, holy shit, yeah, that the man, which is the Halbermansch, is going to be like, oh, everybody's got that tattoo.
Oh. All right, everybody out there, we go look up, blah, 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 blah.
No, Einster Zende Neubauten.
What he said. All right, well, that brings me to the next one. My non-metal number 8, Jimi Hendrix, man. All Along the Watchtower, the goddamn anthem for the 60s.
There must be some kind of way out of here. Said a joker to the thief.
You know, it has come to represent, if I hear that song, I'm in a 60s Vietnam movie, and almost immediately it's become so representative of my youth. I mean, that's prior to my youth, obviously, but it's such a part of me. It's woven into me.
You know, as political, that's like a very political song for the times, and I think Bob Dylan actually wrote it. Or did Bob Dylan cover? I don't remember which one did which.
They might have done it together, even if I'm not mistaken.
It's possible.
Yeah.
You know, Hendrix can fucking rip on that guitar, man. I mean, he wails on it. And that one's a little more subdued without kind of sacrificing any of the feeling.
Yeah.
You know,
that's what Hendrix had, man. Hendrix got in your soul. You know, Hendrix had a way of.
He's one of the most emotive guitar players ever.
Ever. Yeah. Yeah, that's such a great way to put it, even, man. I was asked once a while ago by one of my sons, what makes Jimi Hendrix so different? You know, why did he achieve so much in the minds of so many at so young an age? And emotive, I think that's the word. I think that.
Yeah, and you know, Hendrix always said that Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top is a badass, and he is. For sure. And, you know, Hendrix was like, that's the best guitar player ever. And you can listen to those two together, and Billy Gibbons can play, and he can play great, but you feel Hendrix way more.
Yeah.
Hendrix, I mean, you definitely, like, soul. Yeah, you feel it. Like Billy Gibbons can fucking wail on that guitar, man, but you don't feel it the same way.
No, you don't. Number 7 on your list is King Horse on your metal list.
Okay, so this is a very, I would say this is a pretty obscure band. I found them because Glenn Danzig produced the record, and on the first Danzig tour I saw them. They're from Kentucky. They were in a band called Maurice before, and then half of those guys went in to start Slint, which is like this like indie rock kind of phenomenon that like nobody did indie rock like Slint. So, and then half of the guys went to do King Horse. I love this dude's fucking voice. The artwork on this record is amazing. I love every fucking song on this record. They really only did this record and one other thing. I've recently been in touch with the singer. I'm just like a huge fucking King Horse fan. It's got a little Danzig to it. It's got a little country without, that sounds so douchey when I say it, but it actually works. It's got a little punk edge to it too. I mean, no band sounds like King Horse.
So those bands that are on an island, man. I love the bands that, you know, do that. So,
I mean, it's probably one of my favorite metal records of all time.
Wow.
People are going to judge me when they listen to it. It's not for everybody, I'll say.
Let them judge. Hey, I'm not for everybody either. Fuck them.
Hey, me too.
All right, my next one on my metal list then is Suicidal Tendencies. How will I laugh tomorrow when I can't even smile today? As a metalhead, part of my journey, I think part of many of our journeys is that you're young, you're angry, you're, you know, you do have thoughts of suicide, you do have thoughts of, you know, all that stuff dances in your mind when you're a young teenager, man. And I don't think any, for me anyway, there's no musical act out there that quite captured that essence like Suicidal did. Like Psycho Michael got into your mind with the depressions and the things that you go through as a young, angry teenager, I feel like.
I agree. I mean, like, I don't know that those lyrically, this stuff really resonates with me too much anymore, obviously, because I'm a 45-year-old dude. But yeah, I mean, I think everyone, and that was the first record where they kind of like, the first two records were distinctly punk.
For sure.
And, you know, they got the guy from No Mercy, which I think he's referenced in the Send Me Your Money song, brother, I can't remember his last name, but Clark. But Clark is his last name. He brought a bunch of songs and brought that thrash style. And that's right, you know, that Rocky George on Join the Army, but I think that record was written before him.
Right.
So it was kind of like when that band started to really get to flex their own muscles and have their own kind of identity instead of, hey, this is Mike Muir's band.
I talked earlier about, you know, I give Fate's Warning very much the Godfather hat in prog metal. I also very much give that title to Suicidal for crossover. You know what I mean? They're one of those crossover bands that...
I mean, they were definitely one of the biggest, like DRI and COC. They all were involved, but man, Suicide Tendencies were unavoidable. Yeah. Like, in high school and in middle school, like, you know, everyone's like, have you heard this band? Yeah. And I think a lot of it was the name and the fact that it was catchy as fuck.
Yeah, oh, yeah. And they partied, and they were, you know, I've seen them live so many times. They were so great live. You know, it's a great show. So
I mean, they're still kicking it, man.
Yeah, still doing it, baby. Psycho Michael's ST for life. Okay. All right, let's go to our non-metal number 7. Your non-metal number 7 is, dum-dum-dum, Charles Manson. Let's talk to me about Garbage Dump.
You could feed the world with my garbage dump. That sums it up in one big lump.
I actually know this one very well. So
I'm a big Beach Boys fan, and I didn't realize, or I'm a big of that era, Pet Sounds era Beach Boys fan, and some of the earlier stuff. But I didn't realize that Charles Manson wrote a song for the Beach Boys. They just basically changed the lyrics a little bit, changed around. I'm super into serial killers. I know Charles Manson passed recently. It was very of our time. You know, it was like if a band put Charles Manson on the record or their shirt, you thought it was cool.
Right.
Obviously, some horrible shit he did. You can't really just, you know, agree with that. But the reason I picked Garbage Dump instead of like Look at Your Game Girl or Cease to Exist is it's just a fucking stupid ass song, but it's super, super catchy. I have that the Lie record on vinyl, and my girlfriend's like, don't play Garbage Dump or I'm leaving. And it's never good. Like, she can't stand it, you know? I mean, he's off-key singing, talking about dumpster diving, and it's just a fucking... That whole record is awesome, but, you know, Garbage Dump is not for everybody, and it shouldn't be.
Yeah, and it shouldn't be, and that's part of the reason we love it, man. Yeah,
exactly. Dude.
And the story behind a lot of that stuff, you know, with Charles Manson, when they did put that song out, he felt betrayed by it all and all that. There's so many layers to that story, man. So,
yeah, I mean, just as a musical artist in general, there's so much layers to it. But, like, he's not a terrible songwriter and not a terrible musician.
No.
It's very, very of the times. I mean, it definitely has that late 60s.
Hippie-esque.
Late 60s fucking hippie California sound. I mean, yeah. That defined it in a way.
Look at Your Game Girl is like
such a good song.
Wow, yeah.
And I think that Guns N' Roses covered that on the Spaghetti Incident.
Oh, really? See, I've never been a big Guns N' Roses guy.
No, I mean the first, you know, the EP and the first record are great, but they covered Or they covered a Charles Manson song on that.
No, yeah, I'm a liar, actually. Appetite, I would be a liar. And when Appetite for Destruction came out, we all jammed it to pieces.
I mean, that's one of the best rock and roll records ever.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it just... that's one of the... I'll have you back in the future, and we'll talk about songs that need to die forever, and I got a feeling some Guns N' Roses might make at least my list.
Oh, I'm with
you. Oh, well, that's a good one. Charles Manson, that's good shit. I'm very familiar with that. I also got into that story quite a bit, so that was, you know, wild for me. So my non-metal number seven, maybe I cheated, but I'm on classic rock again. I went with Tom Petty, man. Tom Petty, it was tough for me to pick a song. I ended up going with Breakdown.
Something inside you is feeling like I do. You said all there is to say. Give it to me. Break down, honey, take me through the night.
It could have been any of the songs.
I agree with you, but Breakdown, I think, is probably my favorite, too. And I was going to pick a Petty song and didn't want to, like, you know, double you. And we got a couple doubles anyway.
Yeah,
You can't help it. And, like, you know, we drive each other crazy trying to be like, all right, well, I picked Neil Young. You pick a different Neil Young.
No Neil Young for you.
Right. but dude, Breakdown is a badass fucking Tom Petty song.
It is a badass song, man. It is one of my favorites ever, so.
I mean, and you got to think of, like, his career. I mean, first of all, he's a butt-ugly human being. Definitely not, like, a rock god when you think of that traditional shit and marketable. And, I mean, like, every record just had fucking hit after hit. And See Kids is what we were talking about with the radio. You could turn on that radio, hear Tom Petty song, blow like Donna Summer out of the fucking water, and then you'd hear like a disco song or early proto hip hop or an R&B song, and then another like righteous fucking rock jam.
Yeah, man, crazy. Well, you know, when it comes to Tom Petty, I even like some of the drippy shit. I like the Stop Dragging My Heart Around song with
Phoenix,
and I like all of it.
I'm with you, man. I'm, like, all the way through Full Moon Fever is fucking great.
Oh, amazing. And speaking of Stevie Nicks, good God, did I have it bad for her when I was young. But anyway. number six on your metal list is a good one. Anthrax Among the Living, my friend.
That whole record to me is flawless, and the whole reason I picked that particular song is because of the pandemic, what's going on right now. That's based on the Stephen King book, The Stand, which is about a global pandemic that wipes out, like, you know, 9/10 of the Earth's population.
They just redid that, by the way. That's a mini-series on right now, yeah.
I've been watching it. I haven't watched the last episode. I will say that Stephen King in general is great if you're a teenager, but it doesn't hold up too much.
true.
When you get older. But it's just a kick-ass song, man. And picking any real Anthrax song is tough. Like, it was between this or Lone Justice off the record before that, which is about another Stephen King character. But I went with this one just basically because of COVID.
Fuck yeah, dude. Yeah. I know Anthrax gets a lot of shit. I see post after post after post of people saying, oh, they're not part of the Big Four. Man, Anthrax was such an integral part of the scene. And, man, I love it. Yeah.
And, you know, like, they had those nasty-ass breakdowns, and, like, because they were from New York, they had part of New York hardcore in their sound.
For
like,
sure.
Metallica had breakdowns and Slayer breakdowns, but not like Anthrax. Like, you fucking started swinging with those breakdowns.
Yeah, boy, they incorporated that feel. I totally agree, you know.
And, I mean, like, it might have been the first time I've heard the word mosh in a song.
Yeah, and they brought on the knot thing. Remember? Knot, you know, that whole thing. They were cool. They weren't just a band. They were cool. They brought a cool element in my
mind. Way before Wayne's World.
Way before Wayne's World. And add-on, I guess, is that, in my opinion, the last two Anthrax albums are top shelf. They've been amazing. Two amazing records.
Yeah, they're really good. I mean, there's even some of the ones with, John Bush, Joey Belladonna,
right.
That are pretty good, too. But, you know, they, like, never broke up, so I think that you know, their career didn't skyrocket. They never broke up. I think for a while they were just mostly forgotten about. You know, you kind of get sick of, like, oh, these guys again. Sometimes, you know, when the grunge explosion kind of wiped a lot of that shit off the mat.
Ugh.
You know, Anthrax was like on an independent record label then.
I hate fucking grunge.
I could make you a top 10 list that you probably would like, but yes, as far as like radio grunge, yeah, that's not my thing at all.
I have such a visceral reaction to it because of its role it played in bringing our thing down. You know, I'm such a lifelong metal freak that it did us damage at one point, man, you know?
I agree, and I don't think that there's a particular sound. I mean, like, if you listen to Soundgarden and Nirvana or Mudhoney, none of those bands sound similar to each other.
Oh, I agree.
You know,
I still to this day say Alice in Chains is not a grunge band. They were
they're a hard rock band.
Yeah, exactly. Oh well, let's see. My number six on my death. My number six on my metal list is Death. I went with Death. I went with Baptized in Blood because that album, Scream Bloody Gore, is so in my guts. It's so in my soul. And, you know, when I first got that album, them and Venom were probably two of the earliest bands in my life where I really felt like by listening to the music almost I was doing something wrong. Like, I felt like I should hide it from my parents and shit, you know? Like,
I mean, I felt the exact same way. Like, I would give Venom that, Possessed and...
Possessed, yeah.
And Repulsion, too. But, yeah, you were like... It was so over the top for the time, and insane. Nobody was doing it. What's awesome about Death is, like, it's not just a bunch of idiots bashing it out. Like, there's actual composition there and music theory and stuff. Like, he's a really talented songwriter.
Oh, yeah. Chuck was ridiculous.
And, you know, he just had to fire everybody every record because he needed different players. And every single record sounds, aside from Scream Bloody Gore and Leprosy and parts of... Spiritual Healing, they all sound different.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, such a different flavor, man. Where do you fall on the Chuck debate? If he was here today, would he be 100% prog at this point? No death metal at all?
I mean, he started going that way at the end when he had that other band, was that Control Denied with Richard Christie?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think he would do that, but I think the allure of, hey, we're rocking and we are going to give you like $200,000 to get Death back together, I think that might change it.
That does have a strong argument, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Although, I will say, we were just talking about Anthrax, Billy Milano we had on the show not too long ago, and he's apparently turned down ridiculous amounts of money to get them guys back together and do some SOD stuff.
Yeah, but I don't know that that's always up to him.
Yeah, right.
So, yeah. But yeah.
Let's do your number six non-metal song, which is Bad Seeds, Red Right Hand.
So it's Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds.
His shadow is cast wherever he stands. Stacks of green paper in his red right hand.
And if you've heard this song and once you play it, everyone will be like, oh, that's from 18 different movies. It's kind of hard to explain his vibe. He has a couple different eras, but, you know, it's definitely like this post-punk, real kind of dark and gothy, but not over the top gothy. Like, he makes fun of goth music. This is probably not my favorite, but it's the most accessible one. Like, if you aren't, before you do a deep dive into Nick Cave, do research if you like the song, because it doesn't all sound like that. But it's been in, like, I don't know, probably 7 or 8 movies legitimately. And it's just a badass track, man. Like, it's got, you know, like a piano thing here and there, and like a bell here and there. And like, it's very sparse. It's just a cool, dark song.
Well, how funny is it that movie songs, man, they do tend to, it elevates it in a way. It's so true, man. There's some songs that are tied to the music in the movie, and it is.
And I had some friends that were super into Nick Cave at the time, and they were kept telling me about him. And I was like, I don't know, man, like just based off his look and his record covers, I'm like, I don't know how I feel about any of this, but didn't listen to it. And actually, the first time I heard Nick Cave was Red Right Hand, and I don't remember which movie. And I was like, holy shit, that song rules. And it was, like, perfect for the scene. It's just, you know, it's a good thing.
That's good shit. That's good shit. So grab down and listen to some Nick Cave, metalheads. All right, my number six on my non-metal list, and then we'll play some music for everybody, is I went with Pink Floyd. I went with old Pink Floyd, Wish You Were Here.
Running over the same old ground. What have we found? Same old fear. Wish you were here.
Another song that when it comes on, I drop everything. I sing every word out loud with all of the emotion I can muster. You know, I could be in the middle of fucking a business meeting and everybody's got to shut up so that I can, you know, did they get you to trade? You know, I feel that shit in my guts every time I hear it.
Working outside when I was a kid growing up where you grew up, a lot of my classic rock has kind of been beaten out of me because it was all like, you know, I'm doing construction on a house and like, hey man, you're in a band, you like Zeppelin? I'm like, I do, but I don't listen to fucking 12 straight hours of it.
Right.
Same thing with Pink Floyd. Like, I really like a lot of the stuff. But Wish You Were Here is a timeless fucking song. I mean, it's just from the second it opens, you know, and you know every word, and you know where it's going to go, and you know it's always going to pay off.
Every time. And for me, it never gets old. And that's the point of this list we're doing here is the never get old songs, my friend. And I appreciate you hanging out with me for it, Blake. Let's play some songs for everybody, and we'll come back and bring the list on home for them. What do you think?
Yeah, of course.
Enjoy these jams, ladies and gentlemen. Me and Blake will be right here when you get back, and we'll tell you some more about our forever songs. And we hope that you're sending in your emails and your thoughts on what your forever songs out there, Metal-O-Maniacs. We're talking forever songs here tonight on Metal-O-Mania. I appreciate your time, brother, and I love your list so far, by the way.
Always a pleasure.
And we could talk forever if I, you know, let them. So we went a little long on the last one, and Scully's kicking me in the teeth. So let's jam through our list a little bit together, man.
Yeah.
Let's start with your number five on your metal list, which is some Napalm Death. I Abstain. One of the greatest.
Another tough one for me, man. Napalm Death was the band responsible for getting me into grindcore. The first time I heard Suffer the Children was like, wow, this is a perfect mix of punk and a perfect mix of metal.
Perfect.
I do think that, you know, that's the opening track on Utopia Banished. I think that record kind of gets lost in the mix a little bit because it sounds very similar to Harmony Corruption. But that record is phenomenal. And it might be slightly better than Harmony Corruption, but don't quote me on that.
Hey, I got you on film.
Yeah. So it's just one of those that opens with a noise track and, like, you know, being a fan and doing noise for Pig Destroyer and having some, like, leanings toward other bands like that. You know, it just kicks ass. The song is badass.
Fuck yeah, man. You can't get wrong. And one of my favorite bands ever, honestly. I mean, they do have that perfect mixture of they're just filthy, and I love it.
And still killing it, man.
Still killing it, baby. Number five on my list is I went with Tried and True Overkill and Union We Stand. I know that people are going to hear my list and be very unsurprised that there's a lot of 80s thrash on there. It's my wheelhouse.
It's the same for me, man. It's 80s thrash and death metal.
Yeah, for sure. You know. Well, dude, honestly, there was something transformative for me. The first, you know, all of us, again, we've talked about it a little bit, that we have that kind of angry youth thing in common as metalheads, many of us. But for me, the very first time I was at an Overkill show, and people started, the entire place started screaming, "In Union We Stand," you know, it was transformative for me. It changed my life. It was the first time I felt like I was a part of something bigger than my own lonely, shitty self.
Well, you know, at that time, too, it was such a new and exciting genre. Like, death metal was coming, thrash metal was blowing up. Like, we talked about crossover. Then it was just all metal. But, like, you know, doom metal was starting to creep in there. All kinds of shit, you know. It was a much different world.
So different.
You know, and I hate to, like, be the get-off-my-lawn guy, but, you know, we're similar age groups. So,
yeah, fuck it.
You know?
It is what it is. All right, well, let's move to your non-metal list. Number five on your non-metal list was some Tom Waits. I love Tom Waits, man.
I fell through the ice of Alice.
So, this is later Tom Waits. This is probably one of the most heartbreaking ballads I've ever heard. It was tough for me to pick one. Tom Waits is so much, you know, what he's got, like 26 records or something like that.
Yeah,
very prolific, man. So it was tough to pick one. I mean, like, he's crazy. He, like, picked the worst musicians he could find for one of his records. But this is, like, kind of this comeback, you know, kind of got dusted off in the late 90s, early 2000s. And this is the title track off that record, and it's just one of the most heartbreaking ballads I've ever heard.
What a talented cat, man. What a talented cat. So there you go. And it, look, we're Valentine's Day was just recently. There you go, everybody. Go and get your heartbreak on with some Tom Waits. My non-metal number five song was, I actually went with some little fucking, I went with Young Hold Unlimited, the Soulful Strut.
So I don't know this one at all, and I didn't even check it out. So
okay. Well,
this will be a surprise for me, too.
Yeah, I'm very happy to turn you on to it, hopefully. This is when I was pretty young, actually, my dad was a big Motown guy. He liked a lot of jazz. He liked a lot of fusion type of stuff. Of course, he was mostly country, believe it or not. But, yeah, but this
County.
Was a – yeah, right? I know, shocker, right? But this was one of those songs that was such a – the very first time – I can literally not put on this song without it cheering me up, without it making me feel better, without it getting, you know what I mean? It's literally medicine for my soul, so.
And that's, you know, what Forever songs are about, man.
It's, damn right.
It's either heartbreak or cheers you up or like, hey, man, this has this nasty-ass mosh part or whatever it is.
Or something, right, sentimental. I almost put an Elvis Presley song on here, honestly, and not because I'm a huge Elvis Presley fan necessarily, but it makes me think of my dad, which is, you know, I miss my dad and shit, so.
Yeah, exactly.
So, all right, well, let's move to your number four on your metal list is honestly one of my favorite bands of all time. I almost put Morbid Angel on my list too, but Abominations, man, what a great song. What a great band.
Yep, I agree. And everyone can talk about, you know, how good Covenant is and how good Altars of Madness are. And I think Blessed of the Sick does not get enough love. This song in particular is awesome because of the Lovecraft tie-in. There's a lot more. I think there's at least two songs on this record that have a Lovecraft tie-in. And every single time I go to Atlantic City, I jam this on the way in and I always end up making money.
Hey, well, you got to like that, then. So you heard that here first, ladies and gentlemen. Play this on your way to Vegas. So
it's like you got to see the light, and that's when you got to crank the shit out of it.
So. Hey, anytime you see any lights, I say play Morbid Angel, and you'll be a good. My next on my list was I went with Voivod, The Unknown Knows. From one Voivod record to the next, you're picking a very, very different vibe. But Nothing Face is one of my favorite records of all time, and The Unknown Knows is one of my favorite songs of all time.
So. I would agree with that, and this was tough because I was going to pick a Voivod song. They're probably my favorite thrash band of all time.
Ever.
But so I love that phenomenal band so much, it's impossible for me to pick one. But The Unknown Knows is, I mean, from the opening riff, it's badass. And, you know, this is when they, like, kind of started to turn, get a little more prog. But, man, that record fucking rips, dude.
Rips.
There's not a bad song on it.
No, and their version of Astronomy Divine, speaking of Pink Floyd on there, is just...
Exactly.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing.
And it's kind of, to me, like, criminal. Like, that's what that band's known for. It's like, that band has so many good records all the way through that one, which is, like, what, their fifth, sixth?
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
Every single one of those records is fucking phenomenal.
Yeah, War and Pain and Roar. Oh, so good. All right, well, and then you're next. But this is where we get to your car song. This is where we get – I had my car song earlier. Now it's time for your cars.
So it's Let's Go. You know, I just like the swagger of this song, man. It's just about, you know, I wish I could say this is my theme song, but it's just kind of like, let's go, let's get ready, let's go rage.
Let's go rage.
That's it. And, you know, of course, it's talking about, you know, I think every car song is about a girl at some point,
right.
Which it probably is. But, you know, it's just got that weird keyboard in it. It's got, you know, it was just a little different for the time. And again, Rick Ocasek is a fucking genius.
Starstruck, heartbroken half the time, and a fucking genius.
Yeah.
My non-metal number four song, I went with Peter Gabriel, man. I love Peter Gabriel. And
climbing up on Salisbury Hill, I could see the city light. Wind was blowing, time stood still. Eagle flew out of the night.
I went with Salisbury Hill because that song is just, again, and a lot of these songs are, you know, are forever songs. They're interwoven into your guts. And that song is start note to close note. I can fucking literally voice the every musical element to it. I mean.
You know, I think that he gets, like, because of that and what's it, Games Without Frontiers and Sledgehammer and In Your Eyes, man.
In Your Eyes.
He was a very prolific and all over the map. That dude did not give a fuck what anyone thought of him. He's going to put out the music he wanted to put out, and that's that.
Yeah.
Like, Peter Gabriel's badass. I can't get into his stuff with Genesis, man. Something about Phil Collins drives me up a wall. So,
right.
Even though he's not the singer, Peter Gabriel's the singer for Genesis at that time. You know, like, they were doing shit that nobody else was doing.
Right.
Like, dressing like flowers and, like, just nut shit, man.
That's actually my favorite era of Genesis, man. You know, the debate will go on forever, but I'm firmly in the early Peter Gabriel camp.
Yeah, I can't get into any of it.
That's funny. Yeah, I'm not a Phil Collins guy.
But I love Peter Gabriel, man. I think his solo stuff is like, you know, he quit a very successful band to go solo.
Yeah,
and it was like, fuck it, and still had a huge career.
Well, and movie soundtracks certainly helped his career along the way, too. He's another guy that showed in
my
car.
My God, dude. Almost every single of his is in a movie.
Yeah, right. That's funny shit. All right, let's move on to your number three. Number three on Blake's Metal All-Time Forever list. Number three, Slayer. We both have Slayer represented on our list, so.
I mean, you can't have a metal list without Slayer.
Look, we both have Slayer at number three, even, but go ahead. I'm sorry.
It was really between this and Hardening of the Arteries.
So amazing. Yeah.
I mean, Hardening of the Arteries, the first time I heard it, might have been like, I'm like, holy shit, this is the fastest thing I've ever heard. It's not. But Die by the Sword is just fucking awesome, man. When that breakdown kicks, I kick.
Yeah. Oh. Slayer's entire discography. I was literally known for the first 3 years we did this show by my Slayer hat that I wore. And they're just, I'm going to get me a Slayer tattoo at some point. They're part of my soul. That's one of my favorite forever bands, even. And so you went with Die by the Sword. I went with Angel of Death. We both did them at number three here. Honestly, that song made me love history. That song made me, yeah. I mean, it just did. It had such an effect.
No, I'm with you too, man. I was like, oh, this is about that? Oh, that's cool. Let me read up on that.
Wow, this is so fucked up. Honestly, at that age, I had no idea. I learned a lot about the World War II because of my love Slayer gave me.
And, you know, it was kind of atypical at the time. You know, Megadeth started talking about socio-political stuff. Metallica kind of started talking about socio-political stuff. But not a lot of bands were doing it. Like, metal bands were still talking about, like, drinking blood from skulls and fucking sluts and, like, racing their cars.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's kind of cool that, like, this is kind of that era when that started changing.
Yeah, and it did too, boy. It definitely put things on your face. You know, as a metalhead, you can no longer escape the issues, man. Here we are. Let's deal with it, you know.
Exactly.
Put this in your head, goddammit. This is real shit. Slayer was good for that. All right, well, you're number three on your non-metal list. I love your list, by the way, man. It's a good list.
Thank you.
Hall & Oates.
Oh, here she comes. Here she comes. Watch out, boy.
Oh, here she comes.
So this is a tough one for me, too, man. I love fucking Hall & Oates. I love
You're an 80s everything. Guy like me, Blake. I love you for that, brother.
Yeah. I mean, I just dig Hall & Oates. But Maneater is probably – hold on a sec. Sorry about that.
Nah, no
I distinctly remember as a kid going to a parent-teacher conference at – what was my elementary school? God, Mutual Elementary might not even be there anymore. And my brother, I have an older brother, and meeting with his teacher, and she had these sharp canine teeth, and hearing that song on the way to that meeting. And I think I remember when I was in fifth grade, like, don't get Miss Saunders, don't get Miss Saunders. And I got her. But yeah, I just love like the bass line of that song, the fucking slinky saxophone. It's just a badass song, man.
Fucking badass song.
And it's like a little meaner for Hall & Oates. Like, it's not mean, but it's a little, it's got more of an edge to it than a lot of their other, like, you know, very, very poppy, very, like, Motown influenced stuff.
Well, and how funny is it? It's become almost a musical version of a meme now when you see, like, a nasty woman who's, like, you know, coming for that ass. You know, you almost hear Maneater right in the background.
Most definitely.
It's a song meme at this point. I like it.
Absolutely.
Next on my non-metal list was the Magnetic Fields. You and I have talked a little bit about the Magnetic Fields.
Not for all my words, not if I could write for you. The sweetest song you ever heard, it doesn't matter what I do. Not for all my little words, it doesn't matter what I do.
I went with All My Little Words, but I'm a big Magnetic Fields guy. I know a lot of people might not think that of the metalhead that I am, but they honestly, it was The Shield. The TV show The Shield played All My Little Words, and at the time, I was unfamiliar with the band, the Magnetic Fields.
And interesting, I was like, man.
What the fuck is this song? You know, this song is so – they played it over a very heavy scene, and it was very – I was like, man, what the fuck is this song? And it just led to me getting into the band, and then this song in particular is –
Yeah, I mean, I'm not, admittedly not a huge Magnetic Fields fan, but they've got, like, a ton of fucking shit, so it's kind of hard to go through all of it.
Right.
I think Stephen Malkus is a fucking amazing songwriter.
Genius.
I saw them in the 69 Love Songs tour, which was a little intense because they put out three records that included 69 Love Songs.
Yes, they did. And All My Little Words played, is one of them, by the way.
Yeah, they just played all of that, which was nuts. I mean, it was like... I'm not a huge fan, but I was like, I got to see this.
Yeah.
And definitely like a weird band for indie rock. I think like the stark kind of not, there's not a lot of fullness to the Magnetic Fields. They don't overuse, they don't layer a bunch of guitars. They don't overuse keyboards and pianos. It's very stark.
Yeah.
And I think they were kind of for the indie rock scene. They're one of the first bands to do that sort of thing.
Yeah. Very stripped down, very, relied on the emotion, I guess, is a good
yes. Stripped down is a great way to put it.
Yeah, love it, love it, love it, love it. All right, we only have two left on both of our lists, so let's get through them here. All right, we only have two left on both of our lists, so let's get through them here. Number two on your metal list, one of my favorite musicians of all time, actually, King Diamond, man, King Diamond, Welcome Home.
Oh,
I saw King Diamond on this tour. And it was
as there. did I, sir. Yes, sir.
Well, at Pasadena. I can't remember the name of the place. And this record, them specifically, was banned in the States for a while. So, you know, as a 15-year-old kid or however old I was.
We had to get it.
Yeah, exactly.
There was no better advertisement.
Exactly. Like, fuck you, Tipper Gore. You fucked up. But, like, the solo in this, and, like, yeah, it kind of starts out pretty cheesy with the opening word being grandma. But, like, the solos in this, the way the song moves, it's just fucking badass.
Yeah, oh, even the song being about the subject matter, he's always embraced dark. Every song of his is a movie in my head, you know?
And when Andy LaRocque kicks into those fucking solos, all bets are off, dude. I mean, he's fucking phenomenal.
Dude, one of my favorite guitar players of all time. I've never written down a list of guitar players without his name being on it.
I would 100% agree with that.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, my number two on my metal list, I had to go. We've discussed my love for crossover throughout tonight, so I had to go DRI. I went with Think for Yourself. It was a huge song for me when I was young. It's a very empowering song in a lot of ways. You know, kind of an anthem. Although I guess most DRI songs could be considered an anthem, but
most definitely.
And I know you're a big DRI freak like me, so.
Yeah, I mean, you know, growing up as a punk kid and metal kid, there was, like you said, there was a difference at some point, but like to people like us, it didn't really make a difference. Like, are you playing fast? Are you playing aggressive? Do you mean it? That's all I gave a fuck about.
Fuck yeah.
And, you know, I didn't really realize what crossover was at first. I just knew I liked punk, I liked metal.
Yeah, then, the merging of the two was right.
Right, so if something had little elements of each, I'm like, fuck yeah, it's so, dude.
Yeah. Well, you're old. Do you remember the old commercials for the Reese's Peanut Butter Cups? It used to be like the guy fell and his chocolate fell in the guy's peanut butter, you know?
Yeah.
Hey. Oh, you got your chocolate in my peanut butter.
You got peanut butter in my chocolate.
What?
Yeah.
That's crossover to me. That was two great things came together, you know? Fuck.
Exactly.
Natural. So, all right, our two non-metal number twos. Yours is, I alluded to Elvis Costello a little bit earlier, just such a huge part of my soul, man. I almost had I Want You on my list. You went with No Action, which is a fucking phenomenal song, my friend.
Disconnected in time. There's no action. There's no action. There's no action. There's no action. Every time I phone you, I just want to put you. Every time I phone.
I would say most people now, he's very underrated, but like we talked about it earlier. I think like his first like 8 records are all fucking phenomenal. Probably Get Happy might be my favorite, but it sounds so shitty that it's kind of hard to justify, like, you know, if you're going to listen to this podcast and check out a song. I don't want to start and be like, look, listen to a song of Get Happy. It sounds like garbage, but it's a great fucking song.
But it's a great song.
So, you know, I don't know, man. It's just like the way that fucking record, it opens that record and that record kicks ass and that song kicks ass.
It so does. And I got to think for the crooner approach, honestly, man. There's a crew, like, I'm a Frank Sinatra guy. I love all that shit. I do, yeah, dig all that, you know. And honestly, I don't know how you feel about Alkaline Trio, kind of an indie cross rock.
Yeah,
band.
Yeah, yeah. I like some of the early stuff.
Yeah, right. The early stuff, I always felt like they, if a crooner did indie rock, that you'd have Alkaline Trio kind of, you know what I mean? So.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. Like, and it's like, I mean, pegging Alkaline Trio is hard. It's indie rock, but kind of punk, but kind of not. And
right,
fuck
yeah,
knows,
it's,
but
it's
like,
tough to pin down.
And, you know, Elvis Costello just didn't give a fuck, man. He railed against the industry hard.
Dude, when I was a teenager, I went through a couple of breakups and sobbing bowls of tears listening to I Want You, Sir. So
there you go. If anyone is heartbreak, listen to Elvis Costello.
There you go. Well, my number two non-metal, and I'm worried. I probably cheated with my last two, but I went with Jim Carroll Band. Those are People Who Died.
When he died, he was a friend of mine. Those are people who died, died. 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 They're all my friends. They just died.
This is a song that showed up in a couple of soundtracks as well.
Oh, most definitely, and like by far his only song I think that anyone knows unless you're a huge fan.
Yeah, I am a huge fan, but because of this song, honestly. So
right, that's the only one they would ever play on the radio, ever.
Ever.
And, you know, his story, if no one's seen or read The Basketball Diaries, is pretty intense.
Yeah, Leonardo DiCaprio plays him in the movie.
Heroin addict at, like, age 14, and, like, you know, he was just, like, this beat poet, and that's when he started a band. When he got out of, you know. People Who Died is a great song. I've always wanted to, like, learn it and sing it all, but it's kind of like that R.E.M. song. Like, I'm never going to put the time into it.
I'm not an R.E.M. dude, but I can do People Who Died start to finish word for word, my friend.
That's impressive, man.
Again, Forever Soul, part of my soul. So
most definitely.
I remember seeing a movie called Tough Turf with a super young Robert Downey Jr., by the way, a super young James Spader. And there was a punk band, the Jim Carroll band, played in a party in that movie. And
dude, I've never seen that. I'm definitely going to check that out. Well,
great 80s movie, man. Must see 80s flick.
Love both those actors, and seeing Jim Carroll like at that age has got to be badass.
Tough Turf. Robert Downey Jr. has blue hair, and he's the drummer in Jim Carroll's band in the movie. Great. Iron Man. That's Iron Man, baby.
That's right.
All right, well, let's get to our number ones, my friend. Your number one metal song of all, forever song, is a god of mine. I almost wore my Ozzy shirt for this today, actually, man. Ozzy Osbourne, Bark at the Moon. You're here, Bark at the Moon.
Most of those records through No Rest for the Wicked, like, I love. Actually, I love them all through No Rest for the Wicked. It's when Mama, I'm Coming Home started, that type of shit I didn't really care for.
I totally 100% agree.
But, you know, this, again, we're talking about King Diamond and the solos. It's Jakey Lee, who I think is a great guitar player, but very not as great as Randy LaRoque. But the fucking solos in the song smoke. I mean,
well, and they're perfect for that album. They're perfect.
Perfect, and, like, you know, Ozzy had, like, a lot of songs. Like, you know, there's more, like, loaded, like, Suicide, and this is just a metal song. I mean, it's about a dude turning into a werewolf. I mean, like, and at that time, he wasn't doing a lot of that stuff. I mean, he had some of it, but not as catchy and as hooky as this.
Yeah.
And the video for this is just fucking over the top.
Yeah, it's great, man. It's cheesy, Ozzy, wedges, like, of crazy.
It's cheesy, but, like, Ozzy just with fur glued to him. I mean, it's so fucking badass.
It's great.
And both solos, the solo in, like, the solo part, and then the solo at the end, fucking phenomenal.
Phenomenal. I know Ozzy fans that do not love that record. I don't get it. I think that's a great record. You Can't Kill Rock and Roll. It's a great record, man.
No, that's a really underrated record, man. Fuck, why can't I think of it? Ultimate Sin.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same lineup, and I just don't think people, like, care for Jakey Lee. Right. When you have to fill in Randy Rhoads' shoes, yeah, that's a big fucking deal.
That's a tough gig, yeah.
But, I mean, he took care of business.
Yeah, the Ultimate Sin's a great record, too, man. I live for that.
And, you know, then he's a Dio. Like, Jakey Lee's been in a ton of things, man.
Yeah, he's a phenomenal guitar player. Yeah, you gotta love the dude and give him his props.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's a great number one metal song, man. My number one metal song of all time, and it's our forever song, but it might just be my number one metal song of all time. It might be my number one song, period, of all time, is Judas Priest, Victim of Changes. Whiskey woman, don't you know that you are driving me insane? Ow! Licking you gives that you will to live.
That is up there with me, too. In fact, we talked before, and I was like, holy shit, that's right, I forgot about this one. I mean, when he hits those fucking notes, when it starts kicking back in after the bridge, it's some of the most fucking spine-tingling shit you've ever heard.
I get goosebumps talking about this song. I'm not kidding. I really do. It's from the very first, you know, guitar kind of stumbling into, and I mean, the fucking Whiskey Woman, don't you know that you are driving me? Oh, man, fuck. That's
just... I mean, I agree, and that song's perfect. I mean, I personally, I think my favorite version is the Live in Japan one. Unleashed in the East.
Unleashed in the East is a phenomenal, phenomenal release.
Right, because it's not a real live record, so right. They pretend it's live. But
right.
Yeah, and you know, I think the Stained Class version, it's good. It just doesn't sound. It's not Stained Class. Fuck, what record is that on?
Sad Wings of Destiny.
Sad Wings, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's still a great song, but like when you hear, like with the guitar blaring the entire time and the drums just fucking going at it, it's such a badass song. And I think Halford's first band had a song called Whiskey Woman, and then someone else, Tipton, I think, had another band before that, and they kind of joined the two.
Right, made it into that song, right?
Yeah.
And his voice is just epic in that song. It's
super epic. You don't get more metal vocalists than that, man.
No, you really don't, man. That is epic metal stuff. Good shit. All right, well, let's do our non-metal songs, and then I'll let you get on. I know you got band practice and all kinds of stuff. I appreciate you doing that.
Yeah, of course, man. I love hanging with you guys.
You're a badass and you're a Metal-O-Mania family to be, my friend. So you're number one. And, dude, honestly, when you sent me your list, I'm so angry at myself for not having Prince on my non-metal list, dude. But then I couldn't change it because, you know, I just would be copying. But the Beautiful Ones, and dude, there's so many. Prince was a goddamn genius. I don't give a fuck what anybody says. Genius.
Again, like, his first, like, 12 records are fucking awesome.
Phenomenal.
There's not a bad one in the bunch.
No.
And this was tough because, A, every single song in Purple Rain is amazing.
Amazing.
But, like, his screams at the end of this, when this song builds up, are some of the most, like, you know, Banshee's got nothing on this motherfucker. Like, they're just, it's just piercing, and it's just going nuts.
And you feel it in here. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, he's an underrated guitar player. Like, the solos are badass. There's not a lot of that in this song, but this is a really fucking awesome love song that, like, explodes at the end. It's,
explodes.
It starts out like a ballad, and it's like, no, we're going to kick your ass, too.
Yeah. Oh, and he was good for that, man. He was such a phenomenal, you know, an underrated guitar player, but an underrated piano player, a bass player, he was a drummer. He could play the key. I mean, what couldn't he do?
Yeah, I mean, Prince was basically the biggest musical genius of our generation.
Without question.
Without question.
Yeah. What a phenomenal number one on your list, man. What a phenomenal number one. Well, and we'll close this out with my number one, and it's literally, I don't think I've gone a week of my life without listening to this song at least once since I very first heard it. And I'm yanking out my Fugazi, man, the waiting room.
That is a great song, man.
I feel Fugazi in my soul, brother. I saw them a bunch of times when I was young, and they just infected me, man.
It's actually funny. The drummer for my band, Zealot RIP, owns an art studio, and I was at his studio, and Ian MacKay came by. And I've met him once or twice over the years, but, like, you know, he doesn't remember anything about that, nor why would he? You know, some drunk, snot-nosed kid was like, hey, I like your first record, but your second record sucked. Which is not true for Fugazi at all, but I mean, this is the song that got me into a lot of that DC stuff, man. This Fugazi and Minor Threat are, like, mostly responsible for that. And, you know, Waiting Room is just a badass song. I don't care if you love or hate Fugazi, but you can't hate that song.
You cannot hate that song. Yeah. I would literally break out of my house when I was a teenager to hitchhike to fucking Washington, D.C., to go to clubs, to see Minor Threat and to see bands like Fugazi, man. I mean, those are my earliest, when I think of my earliest days of loving hard music and really embracing the scene, that's what I picture, is climbing out a window to hitchhike to fucking D.C. to see Fugazi.
And, you know, Fugazi, like, never signed to a major label. They had pressure to do so. They just kind of kept their own thing, man.
Yeah. Well, they were not ones to be, they didn't want anybody putting schedules and shit like that on. You know, they were like, fuck
no.
You. We'll do what we do when we do it, goddammit.
Exactly.
And that's what we do here at Metal-O-Mania, man. And that wraps up Blake and my lists of our top 10 forever songs. Yeah, dude, that was fun. I had a lot of fun doing that with you, brother.
Yeah, that was great, man. You know, I love hanging with you guys. I'd like to do it more. Hopefully, after COVID, one day in person, maybe.
Yeah, man. Yeah, you're not that far. Post-COVID, we'll get you in studio.
Yeah, I mean, you guys are maybe 45 minutes, so.
Well, start thinking on our next project we'll do together. Maybe we'll talk about songs that need to die forever.
I'm super into that, and I got plenty.
I like
it. They're all Red Hot Chili Pepper songs.
I endorse that. I endorse that 100%. Well, on that note, we're going to go murder some Red Hot Chili Peppers. We're going to play some more metal for everybody out there. I promise you we'll get my main man Blake back in here to do some more talking with me, brother.
Thanks, man.
You fucking kick ass, man. I appreciate the fuck out of this.
Thanks, brother. Cheers.
This is Waylon of Truth to Void, and that was Crypt and Blake's Countdown of Forever Songs.